So Starship SN4 caught fire during a static fire test last week. What does that mean for SN4 and for the upcoming hopping tests? And what are the other starships doing meanwhile? Then we of course have to talk about the elephant in the room, namely the resignation of Douglas Loverro, chief of human spaceflight at NASA. The timing of his resignation couldn't be more insane. So what could be the real reasons behind this drastic action? And this was only a bit more than a week before the Crew Dragon Demo 2 mission, where preparations are intensifying for the historic launch this week, on Wednesday, the 27th of May.
Then let's talk about Jim Bridenstine's condemnation of China's Long March rocket re-entry. Another action which could tip the scale towards an upcoming Cold War between the US and China. But don't worry, because the Space Command has everything under control and has even updated its mission statement. And let us tell you, it is some really patriotic stuff. And lastly, some news on Mars colonization. Should we be modifying our genes in order to live on Mars? As always, a lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
Okay, so it happened again. Not an explosion this time, but still, let's say, an unintended anomaly occurred during the last week's static fire test of Starship SN4. We remember that SN4 got a new Raptor engine installed, the SN20, and had to undergo some new static fire tests before it can perform the 150-meter hopping test. So Starship SN4 already performed quite a few static fire tests without encountering any problems. But then, during the latest static fire test last Tuesday, the test might have gotten a bit too fiery. So after the test, we could witness SN4 burning in the lower section. There even appears to have been a methane leak in the lower section, which continues to burn for some time. Luckily though, SN4 doesn't seem to have been damaged severely. But now it's unclear how long it will take to get SN4 flight ready again. Of course, this will impact Starship's 150-meter hopping test, which should have already taken place by now. But currently, we will have to wait. We can see that SN4 is still on the launch pad. So it seems that still some repairs or enhancements are being carried out. And Elon said that the hopping test is a few weeks away. So what is the current status of SN5? Well, it seems that SN5 is right on track to become the first fully assembled Starship after Mark 1. We remember that the Mark 1 prototype was the last time that we could see a fully assembled Starship with nose cone and aerodynamic flaps. Unfortunately, we also remember that Mark 1 met an untimely demise because of too much pressure. Those poor Starship prototypes. Can you even imagine the kind of pressure they constantly have to endure? So now SN5 will be fully assembled soon, and it will look even more epic than the Mark 1 prototype. There are many more nose cones waiting, as we can see. And work on SN6 and SN7 is going on simultaneously as we speak. And as always, you shouldn't be sad about this small setback, because the rapid prototyping just allows SpaceX to quickly shrug off these events. We are still on track for orbital flight tests later this year, or latest in early 2021. The future Starship timeline is just mildly affected by these events.
So while SN4 was on fire, it seems that things at NASA are also quite on fire. Okay, so let's get right to it. Why did he do it? Doc? Come on, tell us. Why did you do it? Why did you resign not only your post, but leave NASA altogether just 9 freaking days before the historic launch of the Demo 2 mission? 9 days before the first launch of US astronauts from US soil in almost a decade, you decided to leave the agency, Doc? What's going on, Doc? Doc, come on, tell us. Doc! Now, there are many theories why he stepped down. One theory is that it has something to do with the Demo 2 mission itself. However, he debunked that theory himself in a statement to space.com. quote, "The biggest false rumor, the one that I was most concerned about, and I think the agency was most concerned about, was that there was a problem with the commercial crew launch coming up next week that I resigned over. And nothing could be further from the truth." Okay, so that is already good to know. Then the next theory is that it had something to do with the Artemis Human Landing Systems Award. We remember that only around 2 weeks before his resignation, on April the 30th, NASA announced the three teams which were selected to develop a human-rated moon lander as part of the Artemis moon landing missions. We talked extensively about those landers in this video here. The companies that were selected were the national team, then Dynetics, and lastly, of course, the big daddy, SpaceX with its moon version of Starship, which we, by the way, analyzed in this video here. Regarding that theory, some sources said that he might have violated the Procurement Integrity Act, which means that he might have leaked information about the companies before the decision was publicly announced. It's also unknown if that is true, and we might never know, but he said something else which we found extremely interesting. He said, "Look, I made the calls I thought I needed to make in order to go ahead and make the mission happen. And obviously the mission was to get to the moon by 2024. So I don't think I can deny that there is a difference between the things that I chose to do and the need to go ahead and get there in 2024. Aha, highly interesting. Now to us, this doesn't sound as if it had something to do with leaking information about the Human Landing Systems Award prematurely. No, to us, this sounds more like he made some tough calls regarding Artemis, which had to be done in order to make the 2024 landing date happen, and some people were absolutely not happy with that decision. Now let's think a bit together, what could be the decision he made in order to piss off some important people?
We remember that on the 13th of March, Dak Loverro said in a conversation with NASA's Advisory Council Science Committee that he wanted to de-risk the Artemis moon program, as he formulated it, by taking out the Lunar Gateway out of the first Artemis moon missions. This means that the first two crewed Artemis moon landings, Artemis 3 and Artemis 4, in 2024 and 2025 respectively, should have taken place without the Lunar Gateway. Before this decision, it was planned that the Lunar Gateway would be incorporated into all Artemis missions, so including Artemis 3 and Artemis 4. You know that we are not fans of the Lunar Gateway, and we believe that the main reason for its existence is to keep them dollars flowing to Boeing and Lockheed. You know, the companies that just want to build another ISS-like modular space station, this time in moon orbit instead of in low Earth orbit, so they can just reuse their ISS tin can module designs without the need for any innovation. So Dak Loverro certainly pissed some people off by wanting to take out the Lunar Gateway of the first Artemis missions. We can remember that the reaction to Dak's announcement was also quite chilly. Two Democrat representatives, Kendra Horn and Eddie Bernice Johnson, were not very happy with Dak's announcement, and they were even less happy about the later awards for the Artemis moon landers. So this Dak Loverro came along and had the audacity not to pick Boeing for the human landing contract, and he had the audacity to even pick SpaceX, the nemesis of Boeing. And even more, he had the audacity to bypass the Lunar Gateway for the first Artemis missions. Who is this guy? Who does he think he is? These are probably the thoughts some of the Democrat representatives had. These representatives don't want us to land on the moon in 2024 for several reasons. First of all, because Boeing, Lockheed and so on have some really good lobbyists, so there are certainly financial incentives involved for them. Plus, if a 2024 crewed moon landing would really happen, this would make Trump look too good, which the Democrats certainly won't like. And this Loverro guy is audacious enough to want to make a 2024 crewed moon landing happen without our friend Boeing. He must go! We believe that these are the real reasons why Douglas Loverro had to step down. his decision to neglect Boeing by bypassing the Lunar Gateway, and also diminishing the role of the traditional lobbyist companies with his human moon lander awards, made him some powerful enemies.
At some point, he then saw that the pressure was getting too high and that he would have to leave. And he not only stepped down from his post, but left NASA altogether, which speaks volumes. So yeah, being high up at NASA is not a good job these days. You constantly have to walk the tightrope between politics and doing what makes sense, which is diametrically opposed to each other. You want to do what makes sense for the Artemis missions, but politics will work against you all the time. And if you lean too far out of the window, bam, you're gone. Don't believe us? Well, okay, so then what about Mark Sirangelo, who was named special assistant to Jim Bridenstine a bit more than a year ago and stepped down only 6 weeks after being appointed? 6 weeks! It seems that people at NASA are not really fighting over promotions, quite the contrary, one might say. We think NASA executive probably ranks amongst the most unpopular jobs on this planet. Like the emperors in the later Roman Empire of the 3rd to 5th centuries, where being declared emperor was almost a certain death sentence. This is quite sad and is just another confirmation that most politicians really don't act according to the best interests of humanity. Now, we just hope with all our heart that Jim Bridenstine won't step down and that he will stay NASA administrator for a very, very long time. Because if he does, it will be game over for NASA to play any significant role in the future of human spaceflight. Jim is currently holding NASA together. And we absolutely wish for him to stay NASA administrator for as long as possible. So unfortunately now this affair kind of overshadows the very joyous upcoming first launch of US astronauts from US soil in almost a decade. The launch of Robert Behnken and Douglas Hurley is now only 2 days away and the preparations are now in high gear. And this marks a new era for human spaceflight, where private companies will now dominate the future of humanity in space. And by private companies, we actually mean only SpaceX. Because let's face it, the others are pretty much a joke compared to SpaceX. Yes, even Blue Origin, because they decided to partner with the likes of Lockheed and Northrop Grumman, so they chose the fast, easy, the tempting path. But we all know where this path leads, right?
Once you start down the dark path, forever will it dominate your destiny. Consume you it will!
Is the dark side stronger?
No, no. But the busier, more seductive.
SpaceX is the Luke Skywalker in Star Wars or the Gandalf in Lord of the Rings. The only one to resist corruption, and therefore SpaceX is our best hope for humanity's future in space. And this future will start on the 27th of May in just 2 days.
And how this future might look was now discussed during a webinar hosted by the New York Academy of Sciences called Alienating Mars, Challenges of Space Colonization. And the essence basically was that we have to modify ourselves if we want to permanently live on Mars. So in our last Friday's video, we talked about Elon's plans to colonize Mars. And we will put the link to the video into the description. So in this video, we discussed the danger of radiation. But fortunately, this can be easily solved and won't pose any serious problems. But the bigger problem might be the low gravity on Mars. And by the way, we will discuss all the problems we might encounter on Mars in our future Friday videos and offer solutions to each one of these problems. Because yes, they can all be solved. So low gravity might be one of these problems. We already know that zero G is really bad for us humans. That's why a rotating spacecraft for our trips to and from Mars is absolutely crucial. And we have already offered some solutions in our Starship Flow Fix series. But there's no research yet on the impact of low gravity on the human body. However, let's be brutally realistic here. You know how the universe is. Nature is showing us time and time again that it would really like to kill us any way it can. So we have to assume the worst for Mars. One way to solve the low gravity problem are of course rotating habitats. We mentioned them quite a few times already. And our good friend Dr. Joseph Parker had the idea of rotating twin habitats. These habitats would be dug underground by the boring machines and would be much easier to build on Mars than here on Earth because of the vacuum or almost vacuum conditions and the low temperatures, which are just perfect for superconducting magnetic levitation. But the rotating habitats have a drawback, namely it will take a long time to build them. Therefore, our first Mars bases certainly won't have such rotating habitats. Fortunately, there might be some alternative solutions. As discussed in the webinar from the New York Academy of Sciences, we might just have to modify our genes. This was, by the way, also proposed by Dr. Joseph Parker in a talk for the Mars Society, namely myostatin inhibition by genetic engineering, and thus prevent muscle and bone loss on Mars. And let's face it, genetic engineering will happen. All of us want to live healthier, live longer, and we don't want to get brutal diseases when we are old. We will want to retain our mental capacity even at old age, so genetic engineering will happen. Therefore, why not just modify ourselves to withstand the lower gravity on Mars in order not to develop muscle atrophy and bone loss, in order for our hearts not to shrink, so we don't have a higher risk of getting heart disease. So yes, genetic engineering might indeed be one viable solution to the low gravity problem on Mars and also on the Moon.
And on the topic of the Moon, now we all know it's an open secret that China has set its sight on the Moon. We often talk about the new upcoming Cold War between the US and China, and that this will greatly accelerate human spaceflight, exactly as the last Cold War accelerated human spaceflight. And the last launch of a Long March 5B on the 5th of May angered even Jim Bridenstine, who normally remains cool. He said, "It was seemingly a successful launch until we started getting information about a re-entry of a rocket body, a re-entry that was really dangerous. It flew over population centers and it re-entered Earth's atmosphere. It could have been extremely dangerous. We're really fortunate in the sense that it doesn't appear to have hurt anybody." So yes, this is another event in the multitude of events lately that could tip the scale and lead to a renewed Cold War. We all know that the Space Force is a direct result of these growing tensions. And just in time, the US Space Command updated its mission statement, which now reads as follows: "To conduct operations in, from, and through space to deter conflict, and if necessary, defeat aggression, deliver space combat power for the joint combined force, and defend US vital interests with allies and partners." This certainly sounds very resolute and patriotic. We like it. So yes, China's behavior certainly will lead to an increase in US space presence and US space capability. This is 100% clear. And even though we all might not like it, it will at least lead to huge advancements in human spaceflight, helping to accelerate our transition to a multi-world species.
So what do you think is the real reason why Doug Loverro left NASA? Has he pissed off some important people?
And what do you say to the idea of genetically modifying ourselves in order to be able to live on Mars and withstand the lower gravity there?
And based on the current progress of Starship at Boca Chica, we updated our assessment of Elon's Mars timeline. So if you missed that video, you can check it out right here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and then I would say, on to the future.
You can check it out right here.
Voll gut.
Really?
Yes. Don't want to shoot anything now. This mask.